Welcome to session 3 of our Podcasting 101. We've talked about the tech, we've talked about how to create great content, and then today we're going to talk about distribution and marketing. What the heck do you do with your audio file once you've went through the whole process? So we're going to talk about that. So who am I and why should you listen to me? Well, remains to be seen, but my name's Kim Kessler, and like I said, I'm a writer. I've been pursuing writing and how do I build my own platform, try to get my own website. You know, they talk about you need to like have all this stuff established before you ever put your book out. So I went to some writing conferences, and there was a class on this that talked about, you know, how to use your podcast to, you know, promote your book, to build your brand, that kind of thing. And so from taking that class, I was able to get some information and then just start my own research, because there's so much information online about this already, which I have some resources that I'll give you guys at the end so you can continue your own education on this topic. So I'm going to talk about distribution and marketing, which is really what you do at the end, right? It's the last thing that you do. It's how to put it out there into the world and how to tell people about it. But really, I kind of wanted for us to go back to the beginning, which is right where we are, because when we're done with this class, we're going to go think about our ideas and incubate and try to come up with what we want to do before we go into the booth. So I wanted to just take a quick minute to talk about what are you trying to do with your podcast. So what is your goal, and you know, what's your product essentially that you're going to be delivering to your audience? Because those answers to those questions will answer a lot of the other questions that we're going to be answering when it comes to, well, which platform do I want to use and which website host do I want to use. Those are all going to be determined kind of based on these goals here. So if you kind of know what you're going for, like we're trying to promote our business, right, versus maybe like I just have some really interesting conversations with my friend that I just want to like put out there, and I just want to maybe do something for family and friends, or I'm trying to build a brand for myself. I mean, these are all different things. So are my goals professional goals, or are they amateur goals? And either answer is totally okay. But certain people are going to choose different things based on what they're trying to do and how much money you're going to want to invest in all of these other things. So I like to think about this, you know, when you're coming up with a concept, trying to like hone your idea a little bit, so Seth Godin, who is amazing, and I recommend you look up his podcast, read all of his books, go to his website. He's an entrepreneur and an author and a marketer, and so he always says, no matter what it is, whether we're launching a business, we're writing a novel, doing a podcast, always answer these two questions: who's it for, and what's it do? So when you're thinking about your idea, think about it in these terms. Who is my audience? Who are my listeners? Who am I going to be speaking into their ear? And who do I want to be getting my message? And then what do I want to do for them? Do I want to educate them? And, you know, we talked a lot about this last week with Amy's talk about content. You know, what am I trying to do? Am I trying to educate them? Am I trying to inspire them? Am I trying to entertain them? You know, so looking at those things is going to help drive your concept, which is going to, again, lead to all of these marketing and distribution answers. So kind of a little bit more about uncovering your concept. I like to think broad first. So if I'm, and again, all this stuff applies to the way I think about writing a novel or starting a business. I was thinking this really works coming off of Tri-Cities Launch Weekend, you know, of like how much people are thinking like about their audience and what they're trying to accomplish. So yeah, you know, think about your genre, your category, themes, topics. I'm still really trying to hone what my idea is. I kind of feel all over the place with it. And so just, you know, be thinking about the broad themes. Like if you were to go, you know, go look at the iTunes categories of what, you know, on iTunes, the podcast categories, what are they? You know, and so what ones could you possibly fit into? And how are you going to want to do that? And then, you know, going and looking at what already exists and knowing, okay, well, what am I bringing to the table that's different? You know, what's my hook? What's my angle or my extra, you know, niche that I'm going to be bringing that my voice is going to be added to this conversation? So kind of thinking broad first and then trying to figure out what your specific angle is. I think it's really important, again, before you even really hit the booth, is to try to articulate your concept. What are we going to call it? You know, a name. It can be, there's different branding on whether you're going to use your name. If I'm Tony Robbins, you're going to be naming the podcast Tony Robbins. Everything, because Tony Robbins, that name sells everything, right? Where Kimberly Kessler is not yet a household name. And so for now, we're going to go with something else, right? And so just kind of thinking about that of, you know, what you're trying to do. And again, with the name, you know, making it clear so they understand what it is that they're getting. I think We do this for novels. It's called your log line. It's where you boil your story down into one sentence. And I think it's really important for you to be able to do that with your concept for your podcast. Be able to boil it down so you know, it, and that should really kind of drive your, you know, who's it for and what's it do. And so boil it down to one sentence for yourself, and you may find places on your website, you know, to use these. And remember, it's better to be clear than it is to be clever, because you want people to understand what they're getting when they listen to you. You know, I'm getting ready to, like, devote my precious time and my sacred space, you know, of my ears to you and your message. And so I think it's really important, just like with a movie poster, right? You want to know, well, what is it about? Like, what is this? And so it makes people feel comfortable being able to, you know, sit and let you take control over what's going on in their heads. And so I think it's really important that people know, like, you know, NSFW, right? Like, we need to know those things up front, right? And so those things are really important. And then I think from there, expanding it, you know, of 2, 3 to 5 sentences, which you can use as your description on your iTunes store, of going, you know, kind of a little bit more about the experience and the format, you know, we're interviewing people, you know, whatever it is, you can go out a little bit more for that. So those are really great things if you can kind of just, you know, brainstorm in this area and get that creativity going and really try to, you know, find your place and uncover that concept for yourself. So then, you know, again, it'll help you answer a lot of questions as we go forward. Okay. So I just wanted to give a brief overview about the process. We're not going to go into anything about content because Amy covered that awesomely last time, but just kind of thinking about it in these terms. So we have our concept, you know, we know what we're trying to do. So now creating the content is really kind of these three steps: pre-production, production, and post-production. So we're going to have some planning and some research that goes into it. You know, do I need to schedule interviews with people? I need to go find people. I need to go figure out some stuff about what I want to talk about, or, you know, just different things about prepping before you go into the booth. And so you have your notes typed out, you kind of have your, you know, your outline of where you kind of want to go with your conversation, or, you know, just anything. And unless you're doing one of those off the cuff kind of things, I mean, that's cool. But whatever that means for you, for your concept, doing whatever work it's going to take before you get into the booth. And then, of course, production is sitting your butt in the chair and recording, right? And having your people there. Eventually, we'll probably talk more in another session. We'll talk about, you know, like using Skype to do phone call interviews where they're not going to necessarily be able to be present. So that's something we want to research more for later. But I know I'm going to need that, and I know other people are going to too. So we don't have that yet, but we will. So then you're going to do your recording, and then your post-production is really editing the audio, right? So we've got our concept, we've got our content now, we're going to edit the audio, get it ready to go. And then the next step is to prepare it for shipping. Okay, so you need to get your audio ready to go. So what that's going to look like is really, it's all about getting your MP3 file ready to put on your website or ready to put on iTunes, which are essentially both. So it's basically getting a finished MP3 file that's ready to go. So the way to do this is after post-production, you've edited your file and it's ready to rock, you've listened to it for the gazillionth time and you're fine with it, you're going to export your file. Now, I am not a overly tech person. I watched a YouTube video on this today, and it's really, really easy. So I highly suggest you watch a YouTube video right before you're going to do it and just do what they do. So it's cool because there's lots of videos out there of people who, you know, have been doing this for a long time, and they have all the great, you know, screenshot stuff to do, and you can just follow along. But I watched one today that they did it in GarageBand, and then they did it in Audacity, and it was awesome. And it was just super easy, and they tell you all the tricks, like, yeah, you can do it here, but just skip that step, save it till you get over here, and they just tell you all the stuff that they've learned the hard way. So just watch a YouTube video, okay? So that's what you're gonna do. You're gonna export the file from either GarageBand or Audacity, and then you're going to tag your file, which is really, again, watch a YouTube video. But what's cool about it is this is where you're going to put all of the awesome metadata, all of that cool stuff, like, you know, the name of the episode, the name of the podcast, and this is what episode you're on, what genre you're in. This is where you upload your image, your logo that you're going to have, which is kind of like your book cover, right? That thing that's going to catch everybody's attention. So all that stuff is where you're going to put it all on this file before it ever gets anywhere. So this is part of you finishing and preparing for shipping, is getting exporting your file when it's all done, and then tagging all that information on there. So yeah, so like your host name, the show name, the artwork, the genre, and the track number. And again, on the YouTube video that I watched today, it tells you exactly, specifically which fields to put all of those things in. And it was very clear. And so like I said, I would just recommend watching that, Googling one and watching it, and it'll show you exactly what to do. A couple interesting things that I took away today from the video that I watched about the artwork. It was saying that they suggested having your artwork, your logo that you have, be 1400 by 1400 as far as pixels go, but then also having it be able to be read at 73 by 73, which is how big it's going to be on someone's phone. And so you're going to want, when you have a logo made, you're going to want to look at it in both of those ratios. Look at it at the big size, you want to make sure it looks really good, and then also look at it when it's small and how it's going to look on someone's phone. Make sure they can still read your stuff. So, go ahead.
Quick comment.
Yeah.
So, there's something else I was just thinking about when I was looking at this, which is you even have to come up with like a numbering scheme for your episode, because some podcasts say they've been going for 300 episodes, we'll just do 1 through 300, but others do it seasons like a TV show, right?
Oh, so interesting, yeah.
Season 1, episodes 1 through 20, season 2, episodes 1 through 24, because we have more of that. So those are things that even before the first one, you want to be thinking about how the in which makes sense. Like maybe if you have a theme for the season, then you go the season route, but if it's just always the same, you know, like kind of series, then it's better for them just to be numerically numbered all the way through.
That's awesome. I love that. So there's going to be something different about when you're preparing your, you know, your first episode versus subsequent ones, right? So certainly before you can, you know, prepare, when you have your very first episode done, that's going to be, you're going to make sure you're going to have your logo done before you can finish it, right? So that's stuff that you're going to kind of need to be working on and have ready to go by the time you're ready to publish. So yeah, getting your logo done, what if you want, you know, intro music or outro music or, you know, any of that sort of stuff. Those are things that you're going to want to be thinking about, and definitely listening to podcasts in your genre, you know, looking at the artwork in your genre and figuring out how you fit and how you also stand out. So looking at those kind of things. And you know, you don't have to have intro or outro music, obviously. That's just an option. And you kind of want to decide, like, I've listened to a couple where sometimes they start with the same intro every time, and another one where he just starts talking, and then when he's about 5 minutes in, then he kind of does, he's like, by the way, I'm so-and-so, and he does his intro. So it's kind of cool just to find those different formats. One thing that is a, kind of a suggestion is if you are looking for someone to do a logo or, you know, free music or intro music or a crazy voiceover thing, you know, using things like Fiverr or 99 Designs or even someone locally and finding people that can do that for you, to design logos or music. And there are other, like, free music sites, stuff where you can sound effects, you know, there's stuff like that, again, online. There's so many resources that you can pull from that are free. Okay, so that's prepping for shipping. So that is exporting your file, tagging your file with all of the goodies that it's going to need so that iTunes can read it and put all that stuff on there. The next step is distribution. So this is you actually putting it out there into the world. And so there's a couple different steps here. There's the difference between publishing it on your website and uploading it to iTunes. Okay, so these are or Stitcher or etc. We'll give you the list of all the places that you could put it out. But so those are two different things. Different resources that I have listened to have talked about, as soon as you're done recording it or it's edited and you're ready to put it out there, publish it on your website. Don't wait. Put it on your website and put it out there and don't hold back, because you'll just question whether or not it's ready and you'll want to go listen to it again and edit it. And there's at some point you just have to put it out into the world. And again, Seth Godin says, merely ship it. So when it's ready, just put it in the mail. That's all you're doing. It's time to let it go. So definitely you're going to need a website. This is going to be your home online, your online home where people can go and find your podcast. And so you're going to want to put it on there. Absolutely. I've heard other things recommended that then you kind of wait until you have about, you know, three to five episodes, depending on what you're looking to do, before you actually make the jump to uploading it to iTunes and Stitcher and those kinds of things. And then they're saying, you know, so yeah, put it out there, but have a few done and then put it on iTunes. So that way when it goes up, someone can listen to the first episode and immediately listen to the second episode, rather than like, it just kind of creates this different presence in the iTunes store to have them have a few episodes to listen to. And so I thought that was really interesting. Okay, so your website is going to be your home on the web, right? You're going to have a host, right? So a web host, that's where your data physically lives. It's the server that your data physically lives on in the real world. And so there's a couple options for this. You know, there's like WordPress, which is going to be free hosting. There's another one that I had never heard of. It's called Blog Talk Radio. And so that's one that you can use, or you can self-host. And the videos I watched today about it were talking about some differences. And so again, this goes back to your goals. What is it you're trying to accomplish? What are you trying to do? Depending on what those are, will change your answers to this question of what you're really trying to do. So like WordPress is free, which is great. It's going to be, you know, free web hosting. You can put your podcast out there on it. But certainly if you're planning on trying to, you know, grow your podcast to the point where you can sell ads, you know, and or have a lot of traffic, you know, as far as like having a bunch of people trying to access it at the same time, it will change their experience. It might not be, you know, really a great listening experience if they're all just hosted on a free WordPress site. Does that make sense? It's not going to necessarily have the same resources dedicated to you on a free site that you would have if you were self-hosting, for example. And if you have people trying to access your website and your podcast at the same time, it can bring your website ability, you know, buffering. I'm not sure what the right word is, but you know what I'm saying. Make it really slow and not a great user experience, and again, with the podcast. So, but again, it's free, but if you're looking to be able to, you know, sell ads on your space or those kind of things, that you're not going to be able to do that through a free WordPress site. Blog Talk Radio is, again, I believe it's free, but that is where you're not going to have a whole lot of control over the page. So again, depending on what your goals are, it might be a great fit because you don't have to do a lot of web building or whatever. You just kind of use their template and you put it out there. But really the only thing I believe that you have a lot of control over is kind of like having your logo and your name, but otherwise it's pretty much just like I kind of picture almost like how like the yellow pages are, right? Or the white pages online, you know, those, they just kind of give you this directory of the different podcasts that are listed there. The other thing that he mentioned was that the beginning of the podcast is kind of going to have their Blog Talk Radio, like, blah, 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 like, promo information at the beginning or maybe at the end. So, again, you'll lose a little control over what your site's going to look like and what sort of stuff's going to be on there. So, again, it might be free and it might be a great fit for what you're trying to do, but it might not be. So, self-hosting is going to give you the most flexibility, but again, it's probably going to be more expensive. There's still a lot of really inexpensive ways to do it, and so you kind of just need to, I would say, start small and grow. And certainly, so that's where you can, you know, you can have like hosting through like Bluehost, I believe, is the main one that a lot of people use, and there's a gazillion of them. But yeah, so that type of thing where you're going to be paying to have your stuff hosted on someone else's server. So the other thing they talk about, which again, this goes back to what your goals are, is using your web host versus a media host. So your website is always going to have to be hosted somewhere. It's going to have to live somewhere. But what can happen is your podcast can be on a separate server from your website, and that way they don't compete. When you have a million listeners, because we're all going to have a million listeners, all trying to access our website and our podcast at the same time, it can, like I said, bring your efficiency of your website down because they're all trying to access the same place. Where you could get a separate media host server. Some examples were it's called like Amazon 3, and also Libsyn was another one. The thing about Amazon 3 is they pay by the size of the data. And where Libsyn's going to be more like a flat fee. So the guy today on the video, he said that he was caught with like a really high bill because he all of a sudden must have just had like, I mean, he has a ton of listeners anyway, but you know, just a big influx. And so even though it's only like 0.0018 cents per gig or whatever it is, like he got caught with like a really big bill and he was like, oh. And so anyway, so then he uses Libsyn because it's a flat no matter what. And so that was just one thing he was talking about, how thinks is important to have a separate media host for your podcast files that just, I mean, they still go to your website, but then they just, when they actually go to listen, and when iTunes actually goes to send them, they go to this other thing, and it's just, they're not competing. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's almost like, just to give some tech background, like
yes.
having
Thank
your
you.
Podcast on like Dropbox or something, or Google Drive, which you can actually do that too, and then just have a website link, and when they click it, it downloads it from Google Drive or Dropbox or Amazon S3.
It's like embedding a YouTube video.
Yeah, and if you do want to look into doing your own website and actually running it yourself so that you have better capacity, the same YouTube page where we're going to post these videos, I actually did a tutorial on making your own WordPress site that's hosted in Amazon. There is a free tier, but after you get into the bigger ones, it does cost money. So it just kind of depends on what you need.
Okay, so you got your website. It's going to be your home on the web. You're going to have your host, which is where your data physically lives, and you may want to have a separate host for your website versus your media files, depending on your needs. And then you're going to have, it's something that's called a feed. So that's where basically you're going to be taking, so remember what we said, your first episode, as soon as you're ready, put it on your website. Boom, it's done. When you're ready to upload it to iTunes, maybe you're three episodes in, you're like, okay, it's time to pull the trigger and get ourselves out there, and we're going ahead and upload to, let's say, iTunes or Stitcher or Google Play, SoundCloud, one called maybe like TuneIn Radio, BlackBerry, Zune. So there's lots of different places, and you can kind of decide what you want to do, if you want to go to all of them or you just want to focus on a few. So doing that, again, I watched some really awesome videos on how to do that today, and one of them I kind of want to show you because it just kind of made more sense to me. Just kind of how all this tech background stuff works. He drew this really cool picture, so I'll bring that up and show it to you. You're basically just, the first time you publish versus subsequent ones is going to be a very different process. So the very first time you're ready to get out of your website and go onto iTunes, you're going to want to go set it up. There's a way that you go into your website and you get the RSS URL, which is your feed link, and you basically paste that into iTunes and you give it to them. It's going to have all that metadata, your logo, your description, all that stuff's going to be on there, and you send it to them, and then they're going to listen to it, and then they're going to put it in their iTunes cache stuff, and it can take anywhere from 1 to 14 days to get back to you to go, okay, you're on iTunes now. He's like, maybe it'll take an hour, but sometimes it might take a while for you to very first be on iTunes. But then after that, after you've done that first process and they vetted you and they like put you up there and they say you're okay to be on there, then you're going to set it up where now that feed URL that you've pasted onto there, every time you post a new episode on your website, it's automatically going to go, cool, I have an MP3 player, or I have an MP3 file, sending it to iTunes. Like, it automatically does that. So from then on, once you do that first one where you've put that RSS URL feed on iTunes, then every time you publish, basically you go to your, let's say your WordPress, and you do a blog post, and you attach your MP3 file there, that updates your RSS URL feed. It says, oh, we have an MP3 file, and then iTunes has that link, and it recognizes that, and then it will upload it automatically to the iTunes, Stitcher, etc. So, again, you kind of have to go around the first time and go to each one of those sites. You're going to go to iTunes, and you're going to do that. You're going to go to Stitcher and do that. You're going to go to Google Play and do that, and you do that all first, and then you just update your own website with this RSS feed, and then it will then, after that, disseminate into the world. Does that make sense? So, that first time out, it's going to be a lot of work, but then after that, it should just be, you basically are just kind of dealing with your own website where you're just doing blog posts that have your MP3 file on them and any like show notes or any links to any other things that you want in that blog post, and then from there, then it just should automatically upload.
Just another thing to put on there, I was reading a story about somebody who was launching their podcast, and you have to realize, say you're going to try to go live on your website and iTunes and Stitcher, like, and you have this big event planned, you can't say, oh, I'm editing up right up to the last minute and then I'm gonna post it.
Right.
Because you're gonna have a failed launch because it's gonna take 2 weeks for it to
yes.
show up on iTunes and 3 weeks for it to show up on Stitcher or these other platforms. So you almost have to have it all done and make sure that it's gonna be up there before you even announce when your
yes.
big launch date is to do all your marketing promotion. Otherwise you could have a failed launch it's not on all these platforms that you promise. So build that into your kind of plan for when you're going to do your first video.
other thing that I wanted to mention here is, so when you're creating your post on your website, you have kind of doing a blog post and you have to do all these tags. Just kind of a, I'm not an SEO expert by any stretch of the imagination, but just a couple things. So the class that I took at that writer's conference and learned about this, I called this guy a few weeks ago and re-talked to him on the phone, was like, hey, I took a class, I'm gonna be teaching a class. So I talked to him on the phone for about an hour and kind of re-got all this information and a few more things. So one of the things that he mentioned was, so not only are you gonna have your tags and your metadata stuff that you've put on there that goes onto iTunes, but also within your within your blog post itself, looking at, you know, how to maximize your SEO stuff, so which is your search engine optimization. So, you know, thinking about what would your post be an answer to. So if someone's gonna go searching on the web, what are they gonna be searching? And he gave me this really great example of like vegan Super Bowl nachos or something like that. And you know, just like, okay, let's say I'm looking for that, you know, and you wanna be the top, you know, vegan Super Bowl nachos post, you know, your recipe for this. And so he talked about how you're gonna wanna have, you know, vegan Super Bowl nachos in your title. You're gonna wanna have it in the context, in the notes of your actual, you know, page, and also in your keywords, which when you publish a blog post, you'll have a section to put keywords in. So having it repeat in all those places will up your SEO, you know, weight that you're carrying there. Also, the title of something is weighted more than the text of something. So if we're talking about a podcast episode, you know, naming your title of your podcast, you know, strategically having show notes that repeat those things, and also having the tags on your blog post, you know, repeat those things as well. Because if I just happen to have a personal story about the time I ate Super Bowl vegan nachos, you know, as opposed to having a recipe for them, you know, if I search for those, you know, hopefully someone's recipe shows up before my personal, you know, blog story about how bad that was or whatever, right? So the other thing that was really cool is he talked about, Google, and how the SEO stuff works is it's also looking at how many other sites link to your site. So that was really cool too. So he gave this example of he has and I can't remember what his actual post was about, but he has some post, maybe it's an interview or something that he had, that like the Girl Scouts of America troop links to his that blog post specifically, and so when you search whatever his thing was, he shows up the most because you have these other organizations that have like used it for their curriculum or like something. Oh, maybe it was English teachers. I don't know. Some sort of there's a link on there, and so every year people go to that link and it links to him and whatever. So it's just really interesting how he said other people linking to your site will up your Google search power. And he said also how powerful those links are. Like if I have CNN linking to my blog or whatever, like that's gonna be way better than if I have, you know, my best friend's mommy blog that only me and the rest of our friends read. Like that's gonna be a totally different thing than if like CNN's linking. So when we talk about marketing and we talk about, you know, trying to get in touch with influencers, you know, and having, you know, connect with those people in your genre, in your sphere, whatever that you're doing, just that there's power in that. There's power in getting to, guest blog post on someone else's thing and promote your podcast and link, you know, and so just doing that and having that kind of mind about, okay, how can I get this out there and getting it out there in different ways, and how all of those things can affect your discoverability. I thought that was really interesting. And I knew nothing about SEO, so these were my first, like, toes in the water about that sort of stuff, and so I thought it was pretty cool. Another cool thing that you can do for distribution is maybe taking your podcast and turning them into YouTube videos, whether with just like an image or, you know, maybe you do a short video clip, maybe you're having a video recording happening while you're audio recording. You know, we've seen a lot of those, a lot of comedy podcasts do that where they have the video and you can listen to it on as an actual podcast. So just thinking about those sort of things, again, what's your goal, who's your audience, who are you trying to reach with your message, and thinking about those kind of unique ways that you could go about doing that and how you could take your content and multi-purpose it, right? So maybe I have this really cool little blip in the middle that I don't want to need to put the whole whole, you know, hour on YouTube, but maybe I have this cool 5-minute conversation and I just really love to put that out there with an image or, you know, a subsequent images or something like that, and just looking at all those ways, because those might be really cool things that you could share, right? And that could go viral or something and then link back to your podcast. So again, thinking about kind of those creative ideas would be really awesome. So let's go over here. Okay, so after we've done all this, now it's time to create hype, which is marketing and promotion. So Justin brought up this exact perfect thing about a soft launch versus like the campaign, and the timing of all of that is going to be really important, making sure your stuff's up, it's live, it's working. A lot of the different resources that I've listened to and read about podcasting, they say, you know, again, it really depends on what your goals are and who you are. Because they've had people that, you know, if I'm Tony Robbins, I have an email list that is like, could fill this room, right? And so all I got to do is say anything and the world will want to listen to it. And that's someone who out the gate, they could have one episode recorded and put it out there, and you know, and that just makes sense. So if you already have certain things like an email list, you already have a ton of social media followers, you know, those kind of things, that's going to be a different kind of launch than me starting from the ground up. And so maybe I'm going to want to do a soft launch, and I'm going to want to make sure stuff's working. I'm going to publish it on my website. I'm going to get my 3 episodes. I'm putting it on iTunes, and I'm telling everybody about it, and all my people are going to listen, and we're in it for the long game, okay? So we're going to go slow and steady, but we're going to be consistent, and that's how we're going to move forward. Where someone else who already has established a platform can just boom out the gates, and that's just different abilities. But again, like someone that's like a business that's already known, even in our community, you know, that may be something where you're looking to, yeah, this is us, we're here, because you have those followers already. And putting it out on your Facebook page, people are going to want to go listen to it. So you're looking at all that stuff and strategically designing how you're going to put your stuff out there, and how early you're going to promote. Because there's a difference between publishing something and promoting something. You can put stuff on your website and put stuff on iTunes, and you don't have to promote it. It doesn't mean you have to start telling the world about it. You can just ease into it if you want. Or you can just, you know, put it out there and tell everybody. There was a couple of funny quotes. Let me see where I put them. I think I put them on my first page. That I thought were pretty interesting. That talks about when you're looking at your goals. It was something about like good marketing. Let's see, what does it say? It's like good marketing is like will just make a bad product fail faster, or something like that, right? And so I was saying like the real key is making sure you have really good content to put out there before you start promoting it. Make sure it's working. So that might be something where you put it on your website, you put it on iTunes, and you have people listen and give you feedback, and make sure that you're really connecting to the audience the way that you want. Because I've never done this before, so I don't know if I'm going to come across just really rambly and preachy or something like that. And so, you know, really, oh yeah, go ahead.
I was just wondering, how do you know that you're getting, objective feedback? If mm-hmm. you're showing this to your friends, obviously
absolutely.
They're going to be like, oh yeah, it's so good, but like you might not really know
how
good it is.
Well, we'll talk about that. I have an idea about that, and I think it really is going to, it's the same thing we do as writers, where you find people who know what good looks like and aren't afraid to tell you. And so I think it's finding those other people where I think we could probably create our own critique group and be like, cool, I'll listen to your episode and I'll give you my feedback. Someone like Jess or Amy or Justin, who listen to podcasts all the time, they're going to have a higher palette for what good sounds like. And so I think, you know, finding those key users that are going to be able to be like, hey, I'd really love your feedback on this, which is exactly what I do with my novel. Like, I'm going to go find someone who knows what they're talking about, because, of course, my husband loves it. You know what I mean? And so those kind of things. So I think that is really important. And finding those people, because, yeah, your mom's going to love it. You know, people are going to love it. And so you want people to tell you the truth. And I think that's where we can, amongst ourselves, as this core podcast group, we can really be that, you know.
One other thing I was going to say is, you know, it doesn't matter whether it's a podcast or it's cooking or it's playing piano or it's playing basketball or anything in life. Like, the first time you do it, it's probably not going to be great. So if you go into this expecting that your first episode is going to take off and go viral and you're going to have millions of followers, Like, you have, if you want that,
it's not going to happen, guys.
But it's not going to happen the first time. You got to try over and over and master your craft
yes.
to really be able
yes.
to lock this in. So if not a lot of people have a lot of uptake, that doesn't mean that you failed. It just
no.
means you have to keep practicing and trying more. And you see a lot of these people who are successful podcasters have a history of doing content that's based off their voice and interacting and interviewing with people, whether they're reporters or whatever else, and it's something you have to get good at. You can't expect just to...
Yeah.
I did this once, and now I'm one of the best podcasters, most well-known out there. So
people think
that's going to happen.
Yeah, I know. Which I always have really big, like, expectations about things, and so I've kind of had to have my own, you know, come to Jesus about it, and be like, okay, slow growth is okay, my first novel I write is not going to be my best novel, it's okay, like, those things are okay. John Acuff has a great quote about embrace your invisibility, and so it's okay to be unknown. It's where you get to grow safely and become awesome in learning and doing those things, and so... but when you have uber performance-oriented people who just want it to be great and they want everyone to know about it, like myself, it can be hard to choose the slow path on purpose. So anyway, but yeah, I think, I hope my call to action at the end of this will be to talk about how we can help each other with that. Okay, so there's some general stuff. You know, we talked about getting feedback. And then, you know, website branding. Again, we talked about the host versus the podcast name, so you're going to want to look at that. Social media stuff, maybe do you just do it for your own personal social media, or do you go make accounts for your podcast? One of the cool things about is creating maybe like a Facebook group where you can continue the conversation offline, and that can be a great call to action in your podcast. It's like, hey, come visit me over here on this Facebook page, and let's talk about this more. And then... again, looking at your audience, who is this for, and what social media do they use? Are you looking at, you know, the people who use Facebook and Twitter, or are they more Snapchat, Instagram generation? Like, and you're going to want to meet them where they are. You go to where your audience is. Another thing about is just it's more about creating community with your audience. You want to be generous. You want to connect with them in an authentic way, not just buy my book, listen to my podcast, do this, do that. It's like offering them things, anything you can give away for free. Those are great ways to build an audience. And, you know, posting articles that might be interesting to them, you know, memes, you know, just having other content that surrounds the conversation, again, maybe either on your Instagram page or your Facebook or within this Facebook group or whatever you're doing, that just creates the conversation around and where your podcast can be like the shining jewel of what you're doing, but it's not the only thing that you're doing. This is a conversation that you're going to now be the expert or the team leader about, and you get to carry this banner for your community that you're creating. So yeah, interacting with listeners is super awesome. You know, maybe taking questions off of your social media, giving a call to action. I'm going to field questions. Please post them. Hashtag me at this. I'm at whatever. You know, and then pulling those into the podcast and reading them, you know, giving them a shout out. People love to hear their name. People love to hear their own thing on there. And that's a great way to create that interaction with them and make it just, again, more that community feel. The biggest thing that you can do, which I think I have a second slide for this. Yeah, it's number one recommendation is set a schedule and stick to it. So being consistent and putting out this, you know, new good content consistently is the best way to grow anything. So, you know, whether you're deciding I'm going to go for it, you know, I'm going to try to launch this thing right from the beginning, don't end, okay? So, like, don't be like, I have this great launch with all of these episodes and it's awesome, and then I'm supposed to be publishing every Thursday, but then it's like, well, I missed a couple weeks, and then a month goes by, and I mean, that's one way to totally just, you know, lose momentum. And so even if you're just, you know, slow and steady, or if you come out of the gates, if you come out of the gates strong, you have to stay strong because you've set this precedent. So definitely, you know, don't have that, if they call it pod fade, where you're like, oh, your episodes just kind of, you know, start to drift, and it's been 6 months since you've put anything out. People are just going to stop checking in. They might unsubscribe, you know. So if you can just do something every week or every month or whatever it is that you're looking to do, like, cool, I'm going to do 4 awesome, you know, podcasts a year. Check out me every quarter. I mean, whatever it ends up being, just set it and stick to it. And that consistency, people are going to know to expect, you know, they come out on Monday. It's Monday. I can't wait to listen to Dee's podcast, you know. And so those are really great things. yeah, connecting to other people in your genre through other sites. We talked about blog hopping, being a guest on other people's shows. I think that might be a really fun thing that we could do within our own community. I think we talked about having the podcast about the podcast. Like, you know, like at least one episode would be really fun. Talk about what people are doing. Yeah, and then definitely taking a step and asking people to come be a guest on your show, asking people if you can, you know, be a guest blogger for them or whatever. Like, at some point, we just have to be brave. And if this stuff really matters to us, we're going to, you know, choose the brave path, and that's what's really going to make the difference. Here's a page about resources that I wanted to tell you guys about. Okay, so there's this guy, Podcast Answer Man, and the website is the same. His whole thing, he says the number, it's a ridiculous amount of podcasts that he's been on, and I've listened to a few of his things and got a lot of information about launching and, like, when you should market, and he has about finding your voice as a podcaster. I mean, there's just a ton of resources on this one. The other one, so the videos that I watched today, just to kind of get myself in the more tech-minded and know what to say when it came to the tech stuff, was this Pat Flynn. He's at Smart Passive Income, and he has this epic blog post, which, again, it's this start a podcast step-by-step, and so it's this whole blog post, but he also has these how-to videos. There's, like, 6 how-to videos that walk you through a lot of the stuff that we've talked about, the tech stuff, you know, he has, like, 10 tips for recording, and then he walks you through, like, all of the steps about, you know, exporting and tagging, marketing and distribution, how to host the web stuff, and how to upload to iTunes, and all that stuff. He has separate videos, and each one's about 20 minutes, so it wasn't super difficult to watch them, and they're really entertaining and really well done. He's got really, really nice production. And then this other one is EO Fire. It's an Entrepreneurs on Fire, and it's the How to Podcast. They have a great episode, a great blog post there. And there's some Facebook groups. So the Podcast Movement, that one does cost money to be a part of that group, but there's 2 free ones that I've gotten into and people post, and it's really cool. So Podcasters Hangout and also Podcast Washington. So I definitely recommend you guys go request to join on those groups. The admin just lets you in, you know, after a day or so. And start following the conversation on there, reaching out to people, and getting involved in that community. So those are some really great resources. Also, just like I said, just getting on YouTube and Googling the specific thing you're trying to solve or want to hear more about, or even just there's going to be a blog post out about it already, or a podcast out, or a YouTube video about it already. And so there's just tons of stuff to glean. So hopefully this kind of just gives you an overview of kind of how to think about it, what sort of things you need to be thinking about as far as your concept goes, as far as, like, the tech stuff you need to prepare for, about the website stuff. You know, we have all the software stuff here for you, so that part hopefully takes that out of it. And then, yeah, just kind of deciding, really honing those goals that we talked about at the beginning of what is it you're really trying to do, what are you trying to accomplish, and then, you know, doing everything else accordingly. Okay, so one thing. So we'll, how are we doing? Oh, we're about, right on time. So let me just show you this little thing really quick. Just wanted to show you this video. So this is one of the videos that I watched today. Sorry, it looks kind of weird, but this is the guy. So this is Pat Flynn. So he's that, Smart Passive Income. And so this video, so he walked through and he, like, did this cool whiteboard thing and explained how the whole web hosting thing worked, which was really great for me to get this visual and have him talk about it, and it seemed way less intimidating to me. I'm like, oh, I get that. Like, I just needed someone to do it this way. So I just wanted to show this to you. And he talks about it, and it's really cool, and I just even, like, going through. Kind of talks about it quite a bit. But he has all the things I said, really. I stole from Pat Flynn. But it was really awesome. Let's see. Yeah, he talks about the feed and, like, all this stuff. And he has some promo codes on there, like, for Lisbon or whatever, if you use this SPI, I think, on Libsyn.com. You know, so he had some cool promo stuff, you know, that he has a thing set up with them. So anyway, I just wanted to show you this image and just know that, I watched these today and I really recommend them. They you know, were short and simple. But yeah, this really helped me wrap my brain around what I needed to figure out. So this year I bought my domain name and I signed up with Bluehost and I kind of haven't touched it since. so now I'm hoping from doing the research I needed to do to teach this class, I feel finally confident enough that I can actually go do it. And so that's how I learn. I have to teach you so that I can learn. So did anyone have any questions or stuff you wanted to talk about or bring up? Jess?
Yeah, so as far as like cost of like posting it anywhere, like
yeah.
Does it cost money to put it on iTunes?
No, that stuff's all free. So really it's just going to be your web hosting stuff that you're going to be looking at. You know, your website stuff and your hosting stuff, those are going to be the things that you're going to decide, do I want to pay for that and how much, or do I want to go with the free version? But yeah, as far as putting it up on iTunes, there's no costs related to doing that. So it's just the tech figuring it out and being patient, and then it'll upload and then it's on there. But yeah, there is no cost for that.
Okay.